Today, the White House is sticking a thumb in the eye of congressional Democrats, ordering former White House counsel Don McGahn not to turn over documents in response to a House Judiciary Committee subpoena. White House lawyer Pat Cipollone telling Judiciary Committee Chairman Jerry Nadler in a letter the records belong to the White House and are protected from disclosure to Congress because they implicate significant executive branch confidentiality interests and executive privilege. But the White House not going so far as to assert executive privilege outright. This coming as Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell moves to play defense for President Trump, calling on Democrats to drop their efforts to follow up on Special Counsel Robert Mueller's investigation.
Baseless accusations of perjury, laughable threats of impeachment. Look, we all know what's going on here. This whole angry barrage that Democrats had prepared to unleash on President Trump, except the facts let them down.
McConnell signaling to Republicans that they should push back on efforts to force Mueller to testify.
And the special counsel's finding is clear. Case closed. Case closed.
But House Speaker Nancy Pelosi firing back, not so fast.
The case is not closed.
As Trump pushes back on probes into his taxes and possible obstruction of justice, Pelosi also accusing the Trump administration of stonewalling Congress to push Democrats toward impeachment.
Trump is goading us to impeach him. That's what he's doing. Every single day, he's just like taunting, because he knows that it would be very divisive in the country. We can't impeach him for political reasons. And we can't not impeach him for political reasons. But we have to see where the facts take us.
And the White House has now made its position on document production pretty clear when it comes to Don McGahn. But remember, Democrats still want to talk to McGahn about potential obstruction of justice. And while President Trump has made it clear that he doesn't think McGahn ought to testify, a source familiar with the matter says that has not officially been conveyed to McGahn. So it remains, as of right now, an open question, Jake.
All right, Abby Phillip at the White House, thanks so much. Joining me now is Preet Bharara, the former U.S. attorney for the Southern District of New York, who was fired by President Trump. Preet, in your view, is the White House's legal argument here valid? In other words, that McGahn does not have the legal authority because he's no longer at the White House to comply with the subpoena?
Yeah, I don't think their argument in total is valid because they're arguing based on, I think, executive privilege, although they have not definitively said they're asserting executive privilege and some other confidential privileges that they might have. That's been waived over and over and over again. It's, I think, a stalling tactic. It's, I think, a game of running out the clock. To be sure, to be precise, there's lots of different things that ultimately, if this gets worked out in a court of law, that there will be different arguments about and different degrees of, winability with respect to those arguments. With respect to McGahn just coming to testify, I think that's a dead-bang loser because McGahn has already talked to the special counsel. Lots of the things that he said to the special counsel have not only gone to him, but have now been made public in that report that we've been talking about for the last number of weeks. They might have a slightly better argument mm-hmm. with respect to the subset of documents that McGahn has, but with respect to the testimony, I don't see how that wins at all.
Is it invoking executive privilege like invoking the Fifth Amendment when you testify or invoking spousal privilege when you testify? Once you waive it, that's it, even if it was waived for Mueller, and we're talking about a different forum here, the House Judiciary Committee.
Yeah, I mean, generally speaking, it can be. There was an argument that the lawyers put forward, which was not a terrible argument, I think, and depending on what the terms were with Bob Mueller, that with respect to the testimony of Don McGahn and others, going before the special counsel, if they explicitly reserved their rights and the special counsel agreed to take the testimony and the information, acknowledging and respecting that there was not a waiver of those privileges going forward, then I suppose there's some argument that's not waived. But then they went the next step further, and all that stuff came out in a report. So you can't have waiver after waiver after waiver and then say, well, with respect to this particular thing that's going to be a little bit ugly for us because it'll be a spectacle in Congress, we want to assert the privilege. It doesn't work that way.
Cipollone, the White House counsel, invoked the notion of executive privilege in his letter, writing, quote, "The White House records remain legally protected from disclosure under longstanding constitutional principles because they implicate significant executive branch confidentiality interests and executive privilege." Would that also potentially include notes that McGahn made to himself, notes that he shared with his chief of staff, notes that he shared with a personal attorney.
I mean, I think they're going to take the position that's as broad as possible because they don't want this to go on any further. They, in echoing the words of Mitch McConnell that you played a few minutes ago, case closed. I think there are fewer arguments with respect to notes that constitute the conversations that he had with the president, because with respect to those conversations, he's already given testimony. A lot of that is known to the public because of the report. The further away you get, presumably, from, you know, the core of what the testimony was and the core of what's in the report, I suppose you could have slightly better arguments with respect to executive privilege. It certainly is not the case that everything that Don McGahn ever talked about mm-hmm. or wrote about can be subject to the subpoena without an argument of executive privilege. But that's where the arguments are going to fall. And that's where you're going to have a lot of delay, because you'll have to hash this all out in court.
And then, of course, there's the argument that I'm sure those who want McGahn to testify will make, which is President Trump has basically been out there publicly on Twitter and elsewhere saying that Don McGahn's version of events as detailed in the Mueller report is a lie, that it's not true. Does that change anything in terms of whether or not the public has a more compelling reason to hear from him?
Yeah, I think there's a common sense argument there. You know, we sometimes say in the law and motions that lawyers bring, you can't use a privilege both as a sword and a shield. So on the one hand, you're saying, you can't hear this information. On the other hand, you're saying, and by the way, the information is completely false. I think you've stated it actually very well. And depending on what the arguments are that are made in court, and again, the hope is that they get to resolve this otherwise. I mean, Don McGahn and his lawyer, is a very good attorney and is a longtime friend of mine and an alum of the Southern District of New York, Bill Burke. You know, he's sitting this one out. And ordinarily what happens is one side or the other reaches an accommodation so that, you know, there's partial satisfaction of what the requests are by Congress. We saw that with Bill Clinton when he decided to testify after the independent counsel Ken Starr withdrew the subpoena. I'm getting the sense here that with an election coming up in a year and a half, nobody's going to be so interested in settling. They just want to run out the clock.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like there's an accommodation coming. So
no.
Where does this end up? Does this go all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court potentially?
I think ultimately, yes. But, you know, if you're talking about it going all the way up, and if the president's team is going to be really intransigent and say, we're fighting all of this, and you outlined at the beginning of the segment in an excellent fashion how many different places there are where there's an impasse, and I think we're going to see a lot more impasses going forward. And if they have, you know, a full court strategy of opposing everything, it's going to take a long period of time. And if they're going to fight all the way to the Supreme Court, you know, I can't predict with certainty, but that's going to take us very close to the election, if not past it.
All right, Preet Bharara, thank you so much. Appreciate
sure.
your insights.